Good morning and welcome to Sunday School. I was greeted with, "You have a beautiful spring morning." Well, it's nice. Couldn't be a whole lot worse. A little cool. Anyway, if you would turn to 426 in our hymnal. If you'll notice at the top of this song, there's a verse, it's from Romans 5:20, that says, excuse me, when sin increased or when sin abounded, grace increased all the more. Grace abounded more. You remember that verse from Romans? This song is around that theme. His grace abounded. Things and especially pray for the lesson. You know, I've gleaned a few thoughts from our quarterly and from some commentators. I pray that God would bless the truth. In other words, it's just like fighting against the wind. You know, it's just, it'd just be words. As we pray, there are some prayer requests mentioned in our bulletin. And if you know or need to add anything about any of these people, you can do that. Kathy Hollenbeck, Marlon Hernley, Jaden Habaker, Shirley Morgan, Bill Obitz, Betty George, Martha Shadle, Larry Watson, and then the convention starting this Tuesday, that God would bless and revive and refresh his people and meet all the needs that will be represented there, various churches. It's more than just for a time of fellowship and handshaking, you know, and patting each other on the back. It's a time of learning from God and seeking God. Our nation needs God. Our world needs God. Our world's in a mess. We desperately need a move from God. Pray for the preaching and singing and all. It'll all be anointed by the Holy Spirit. Any requests that anyone would add to that? All right, unspoken requests. Let's see, who shall I call? Brother Bally, would you pray for us, please?
Heavenly Father, we're grateful to call upon you this morning.
Yes.
Thank you for Jesus the Son, for the grace of God that abounds more than all of our sins.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Made possible by the shed blood of Jesus Christ. We thank you, Lord, though there was a great fall in the Garden of Eden, yet, Lord, you redeemed us. You made a provision out of your great love for us. So we worship you this morning and glorify your name and give you thanks. We pray, Lord, that you'll bless and anoint the word as it is taught this morning. Be with Brother Jerry as he teaches the lesson. We pray the Holy Spirit will empower him, empower the word. Give us listening ears, Lord. Teach and instruct us and guide us in the way that we should go. We pray, Lord, that you'll bless every heart here. Meet the needs we ask, every need mentioned in the bulletin, the needs, Lord, in our group, our congregation. And, oh God, we ask that you pour out your spirit on the convention this week.
Yes.
And, Lord, revive your people. Have mercy on our nation and some way, somehow, establish righteousness and the righteousness of God in our nation once again, Lord. We look to you and we give you the praise and the honor in Jesus' name.
Amen. I meant to mention as a request our Ukrainian brethren, sisters, undergoing great tribulation. Pray for them, the Ukrainian people. And then God's people everywhere. There are a lot of lands where Christians are oppressed and persecuted and afflicted. Well, we have a familiar story. It's a sad story. In the beginning, we know that God created such a marvelous universe and beautiful world made for wonderful creatures, and then for man. Man was to have dominion over it. And then something happened. It's not our world we see today. Still has some beauty and so forth, but a lot of trouble. We live in what we call it a broken world. So our lesson: man, his creation, and fall, or his ruin. Man, his creation, and fall. We will study man's creation, his fall, and the sad results of the fall, and declare how the image of God can be restored in mankind. Central truth: sin has utterly corrupted mankind, God's crowning creation. We can see it in our world all about us. Everywhere we go, utterly corrupted and brought death to the world and suffering. It wasn't supposed to be that way. You know, I can see the results of sin as I look around the congregation and as I think of myself. I can see people getting older. I can see thinning hair. I can see people without perfect bodies, you know. That's a result of sin. That means death is coming. sin utterly. And the worst, that's not the worst part. The worst part is the inner man that was corrupted. The image of God was lost. And man has a bent to sin, a warped nature. Somebody said, called it a bloated self. Man has become selfish, all because of sin. In both Psalm 8 and Hebrews 2, we have this thought. The writer of Hebrews, no doubt, took it from Psalm 8. What is man that you're mindful of him? And the Son of Man that you visit him? For you have made him a little lower than the angels, and you've crowned him with glory and honor. You've made him to have dominion over the works of your hands. You've put all things under his feet. This conception of man being made in God's image and invested with a sovereignty little short of divine, almost divine. Of course, as I said earlier, man was created to have dominion over the world. This conception of man invested with a sovereignty little short of divine is puzzling to the psalmist and to the writer of Hebrews. He asks how it can be that man, being what he is now, can be of such high estate. The epistle carries out truly the idea of the psalm, which is that man's appointed position in the scale of things is beyond what he seems now to realize. Man doesn't seem to have this position. That's what he was created for, to have dominion over this world. And it's different from what we see in our broken world today. But in the beginning, of course, we know what God did. Then God, this is from Genesis 1. God said, let us, the first part of our lesson in the quarterly, Genesis 1. Then God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, to rule over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air, over the livestock, and over all the earth itself, and every creature that crawls upon it. Excuse me. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. God blessed them and said to them, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth and subdue it. Rule over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air and over every creature that crawls upon the earth. Excuse me, I've been suffering from a virus of some kind. I want to go to the back of my teacher's quarterly in this lesson, back of the lesson. I don't think this is in your quarterly or your leaflets. It's called Doctrinal Discussion. Man did not come through evolution. I don't know if I'll get through this or not. There's some obvious reasons why evolution is not true. First, science has never been able to prove that life comes from matter. Living thing doesn't just come from chemicals in the soil. It has only been shown that life comes from life. Again, life has not been traced to any progression of life except by species. Each thing brought forth after its kind. Suppositions must not be accepted as fact. It's axiomatic that from nothing, nothing comes. This, we believe, sets the stage for the assertion that God created man. Nothing can ever turn into everything. That's what evolutionists apparently believe. Nothing became something. The word used for created man carries the idea of a new creation. This clearly separates him from the rest of God's creation. God created it all, of course, including the mighty universe. Genesis 2:7 tells how man's body was made of the dust. But we also learn that God breathed into him and he became a living soul. In summary, man did not come from any chance getting together of chemical components, but by direct, creative, thank you, brother, act of God, and he became a living soul. Since man was created in the image of God, we must conclude that this is speaking chiefly of his, talking about his image. Now, what are we talking about? His body mainly, or what? His spiritual life. He became a soul, created, he's speaking chiefly of his spiritual life. We are made in the image of God in a sense that no other created animal or thing was. In a threefold manner, in the image of God, spirituality. James 3:9 says that we are made in the similitude of God. If that is true, we are indestructible in our existence. That's not true, as far as I know, of any animal, any of the lower creation. Of course, we will die too, just like they will. And we have a part that lives forever. We are made, we are indestructible in our existence. So number one, create an image of God in spirituality. We have a spirit. In knowledge, number two, knowledge. Colossians 3:10 tells us that we have put on the new man, that it has been renewed in knowledge after the image of him that created him. In knowledge, we have a mind superior to every other animal of the lower creation. I have read that the human mind, the brain, that is the most complex thing in the universe. All the interconnections and so forth, it's amazing. But anyway, in knowledge. And then in number three, immortality. Excuse me again. Matthew 10:28 tells us we are not to fear those who can kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. This bears out that we will live forever somewhere. We have a living soul that's eternal. Adam committed sin, and the results were devastating. Amen. My, what's included in that participle? Devastating. And the adjective, or the adverb in front of it in this quarterly, in this part of the quarterly, says immediately devastating. How so? How is it immediately devastating? He didn't die immediately. Probably began to die physically immediately. But they were immediately devastating. Theologians have summarized these results in the following manner. The fall brought deprivation. What was the main thing we were deprived of immediately? Relationship with God, connection with God, the image of God, gone immediately. Involved the loss of God's Spirit. That naturally caused the loss of the Spirit's guidance and a resultant confusion of truth. Light became darkness. When light becomes darkness, how? Jesus said, how great is that darkness? Inner darkness, confusion of mind. We lost the Spirit's guidance, the mind of the Spirit. So the fall brought deprivation spiritually. Of course, we all know about the deprivation in our bodies and how they deteriorate. (Clears throat) Number two, he was depraved as a result of sin. Depravity. Depraved. People with depraved minds. People can go out and shoot other people. We had a police lieutenant just killed just here in town just the other day, just 1 month from retirement, by a man with depravity. And, of course, our sinful nature, our sinful heart, our warped soul, our warped mind, our bloated self is called depravity. The sinful nature, which is passed down to us from our parents, every person is born with a depraved heart that leads the person to begin practicing sinful acts. We're born depraved. And we have that nature that causes us to become sinners. We're sinners by nature, and very soon become sinners by action. Somebody said you don't have to teach little ones to lie or to be mean. You don't have to teach them that. To cover up when they know they've done wrong. It's natural. It's unnatural in a sense, not what it was in the beginning before Adam and Eve disobeyed God. So every person is born with a depraved heart that leads the person to begin practicing sinful acts. And number three, disorganization was a result of sin. Disorganization. God is no longer man's center. What is our center? Center. C-E-N-T-E-R. If God's not our center, self is the center. We do what pleases self. That's our natural, in a sense, unnatural. That's the natural state of man when he comes into this world. Disorganization. God is no longer man's center. And since a vacuum will not be tolerated in our being, the sinner organizes himself around whom? Himself. He organizes himself around himself. The sinner seldom does anything that ultimately cannot be traced to selfishness. Even if he does good, it's generally for the wrong reasons. Benefiting himself, looking out for number one. Disorganization was a result of sin. And then physical and spiritual death, as we've already mentioned, both physical and spiritual death is a result of sin. Hebrews 9:27 tells us that it's appointed unto man once to die. Spiritual death is stated in Ezekiel 18:20. The soul that sinneth, it shall die. From this dark picture, we turn to a shining light that is called the atonement. Thanks be unto God, whose grace abounds more. We sang about it. The atonement is the satisfaction made for sin by the sufferings and the death of Christ, whereby salvation from sin is made possible. And we know all this. I guess everyone here knows all this. Kind of like preaching to the choir. But it doesn't hurt to be reminded again. And maybe someone online that's totally ignorant of these things might be a blessing out there somewhere. And it would help us. Our lesson is divided into, in the quarterly, to humanity without sin. We haven't talked much about that yet, how man was in the beginning. And the dominion he was to have. And then number two, the fall to sin and the consequences of sin. So, humanity without sin, the fall to sin, the consequences of sin. That's next Sunday's lesson. That's Larry's lesson next Sunday. I've touched on it. There's a remedy. There was an atonement made. The first Adam fell. He was to have dominion. Jesus came, called the second Adam. He didn't fail. Praise the Lord. He'll have sovereignty over it all, and does. All right, let us make man in our image. The making of man is so ushered in as to show that at length the work of creation had reached its perfection and ultimate goal, the highest, the apex, God's highest goal. He's building his kingdom. He hasn't forgotten about his kingdom. The kingdom was much in the mouth of Jesus. He is important to him. Anyway, I want to reread that sentence. The making of man is so ushered in, you know, created man in our image, God's image. We might talk about why it says our image. But anyway, so ushered in as to show that at length the work of creation had reached its perfection and ultimate goal by the creation of man. Now we have a perfect man. Who is it? Jesus Christ came, the perfect man. He's coming again. He'll rule over this world and won't be straight until he gets here. In our image, after our likeness, the human body is after God's image in some ways. Of course, God himself is spirit. Human body is after God's image only as being the means whereby man attains to dominion. He has a tremendous brain. He has an upright posture. He has two limbs that are free with marvelous hands and fingers that can do marvelous things. He's higher than all the other created animals. Man's body, therefore, is as of that of one who rules, who is erect, stands up, and endowed with speech. I haven't mentioned that yet. The only reason we're here together is because we have speech. We understand each other. And I can give my thoughts to you, and you can give your thoughts to me. The lower animals have some communication, but not like man. Talking about man's body there right now. One who rules is erect, endowed with speech, that he may give the word of command. The soul is first in God's image. The soul is the most important thing. This may refer to man's reason, his free will, his self-consciousness, and so on. But it's secondly in God's likeness, which implies something closer and more inward. It first demands moral powers, and especially to his capacity of attaining unto holiness. Now man has lost neither of these two. He still has a capacity for holiness. It has to be put in by God, by God's Spirit, but he still has that capacity. It says, now man has lost neither of these two. Both were weakened and defiled by the fall, but were still retained in a greater or less degree. In the man Christ Jesus, both were perfect. Fallen man, when new created in Christ, actually attains to that perfection, which was his only potentially at his first creation, and to which Adam never did attain. Comment on verse 26 again from another commentator. The importance assigned in the biblical record to the creation of man is indicated by the manner in which it is introduced. And God said, "Let us make man." Having already explained the significance of the term Elohim, and I haven't, this commentator says this, excuse me. Elohim's plural for Hebrew scholars. None of us are, far as I know. But Elohim is suggesting the fullness of the divine personality foreshadowing our learning about the doctrine of the Trinity, God in three persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. But he said, let us make man in our image. How so? Number one, in the spirituality of his being as an intelligent and free agent, free will. He's intelligent, mankind, and he's free to choose, free to do what he wants. In the moral integrity and holiness of his nature and in his dominion over the creatures, the lower creatures, over the creation. Now, here's an important point that I wanted to make. We're to look to Genesis more than for a scientific cosmogony. Far more important is to imprint the deep and ineffaceable conviction that one God created everything. It's one of the main purposes of Genesis. In the beginning, God. One God, not many gods, only one, and created everything. The revelation which it gives is the truth that one God in the beginning created the heaven and the earth. That solemn utterance is the keynote of the whole. The rest but expands it. It was a challenge and a denial for all the beliefs of the nations. Who are polytheistic. What does that mean? Belief in many gods. Heathen believe in many gods. Today we have a lot of people like that even in our fair land who worship all sorts of gods. But anyway, Genesis tells us only one God. We can scarcely estimate the grandeur, the emancipating power, the all-uniting force of that utterance. In the beginning, God, one God, created everything. Physical science has not spoken the final word when it has shown us how things came to be as they are. There remains the deeper question, what or who originated and guided the process, and for what reason? And the only answer is the ancient declaration, in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. There is no other agency than the putting forth of the divine will. All things are made by him, whose name is the Word of God. He spoke, and it was done. That's the sign manual of deity. So that is emphatic. One God created it all. Number next, the completeness of creation is emphasized. We note not only the recurrent, repeated, and it was so, that God saw that it was good. His ideals are always realized. He has no hindrances nor incompletenesses in his creative work. And the very Sabbath rest with which the narrative closes, on the seventh day, remember, God did what? He rested. For what reason? Was God tired? No. God doesn't get tired. I mean, it was complete. Perfect. He did it. His ideals are always realized. It was not to show his need for repose, for rest, but his perfect accomplishment of his purpose. God ceases from his works because the works were finished, and he saw that all was very good. Praise the Lord. The progressiveness of the creative process is brought into strong relief. It was progressive on day one, on day two, on day three, such and such and such. The manner of it was not a sudden calling forth of the world, everything all at once here. He did it progressively over 6 days. Majestic, slow advance by stages, each of which rested on the preceding. To apply the old distinction between justification and sanctification, creation was a work, not an act. It was a work of God. The divine workman who is always patient, works slowly, then as he does now. Not at a leap, but by deliberate steps, the divine ideal attains realization. The creation of living creatures on the fourth and fifth days is so arranged as to lead up to the creation of man as the climax. On the sixth day, the earth is replenished with living creatures. Then last of all comes man, the apex of creation. Obviously, the purpose of the whole is to concentrate the light on man. God made all the universe. He prepared the earth for the delight of living creatures. But between man and them, the other creatures, there is a gulf. Since man is made in the divine image, the image implies personality, the consciousness of self, the power to say I, as well as purity. Well, enough of that. That's quite a bit on the creation. God made it, one God. He made it perfect over a period of time. And then the sad part, of course, was the fall into sin. The fall to sin. The result of sin, of course, we know the story about the Adam and Eve story and how they disobeyed God and brought disaster, ruin to mankind, to this world. And death. The result of sin, when it's fully carried out, is death. Death in all forms. The idea is that death, in whatever form it exists, is to be traced to sin, and that sin will naturally and always produces death. James 1:15, then when lust hath conceived, it bringeth forth sin, and sin, when it's finished, bringeth forth death. Anyone who indulges in a sinful thought or corrupt desire should reflect that it may and will end in death. Death temporal and eternal. Its natural tendency will be to produce such a death. This reflection should induce us to check an evil thought or desire at the beginning. Stop. Check it. Not for one moment should we indulge in it, for soon it may secure the mastery of us, be beyond our control, and the end may be seen where? Where will we end up? Sin, when it's finished, bringeth forth death. The end may be seen in the grave, and beyond that, the awful world of woe. The commands of God and the dealings of His providence try men's hearts and show the dispositions which prevail in them, but nothing sinful in the heart or conduct can be ascribed to God, can be traced to Him. He's not the author of the dross, though His fiery trial exposes it. The origin of evil and temptation is in our own hearts. Stop the beginnings of sin, or all the evils that follow must be wholly charged to whom? To God? No, not to God. To myself, to you, to mankind. Said, what I've said here is God can't be charged with evil. The origin of sin and temptation is in our own hearts, and we cannot charge God with it. God has no pleasure in the death of men. He has no hand in their sin. But both sin and misery are owing to themselves. As the Son is the same in nature and influences always, though the earth and clouds often coming between may seem to us to vary, so God is unchangeable. And our changes and shadows are not providence, not from any changes or alterations in Him. What the Son is in nature, God is in grace. Always the same, always offering His grace to those who will receive it. Those who fly to Him for refuge and for forgiveness and cleansing, for restoration, for redemption. As I've said already, God has no pleasure in the death of men and has no hand in their sin. What the Son is in nature, God is in grace, providence, and glory, and infinitely more. As every good gift is from God, so particularly our being born again and all its holy, happy consequences come from Him. A true Christian becomes as different a person from what he was before the renewing influences of divine grace, as if he were formed over again. We're spoken of as being new creatures. Another creation, marvelous, marvelous. God can take a poor, depraved, lost, mean, wicked sinner and turn him into a saint. Creation of God. Well, don't have a lot of time left. Kind of go over this in our scriptures. We've already read the Genesis, God let us make man in our image. And then the second scriptures of the Genesis story of man's fall. Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, yea, hath God said, ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden? Is that what God said? Or did he lie? The devil's a liar from the beginning. He told a big fat lie. God didn't say that. He didn't say you don't eat of every tree of the in the garden, only one. And the woman said unto the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God hath said, you shall not eat of it, neither shall you touch it. Did you say that? He told them not to eat it. Did you say not even to touch it? Well, that might be a good thought, you know. Stay away, far away from temptation as you can. But anyway, she kind of exaggerated what God said. It says in the beginning, Eve seemed to see through the tempter's trick, his tactics. She corrected his negative approach with a positive statement. She emphasized that the prohibition related to only one tree. However, she did exaggerate in her own statement, quoting God as saying, neither shall you touch it. The serpent then dropped verse 4 there, and the serpent said to the woman, you shall not surely die. The biggest lie of all. The serpent dropped his craftiness and made a direct challenge to the truthfulness of God. He saw that the woman's hesitancy to disobey was based upon the punishment promised and not a desire to live in relationship with the Creator. When punishment is the only deterrent, we will soon minimize the punishment. And then on verse 5 there, for God doth know the day you shall eat thereof, your eyes shall be open, and you shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. Serpent's third strategy was to question God's motives. In the process, he, a created being, pretended to know the inner thoughts of the Creator. Excuse me. In a sense, this statement serves as the serpent's definition of a God, someone who knows good and evil. The effect was to challenge the goodness of God, to charge him with knowingly withholding from his creation something that would benefit them. And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food and it was pleasant to the eyes and a tree to be desired, to make one wise, she took thereof and did eat, and gave it to her husband, and he did eat. They had focused upon the good possibilities and ignored the bad. They didn't have any. I don't suppose they had any idea of the devastation they were about to create, the ruin that they were bringing upon themselves and on the world. But they just looked at it was good to see, it would be delicious to eat. You know, why not? God's withholding something from us, you know, that would help us. That's the lie of Satan. Well, I'm going to have to close here. And we've already talked some about the consequences of sin. Yes.
So much with young people, especially what they can't have because.
And another problem with young people is wanting the immediate, you know, what's good right now, not looking down the road. It takes a while grow in wisdom until we have sense enough to think what's the long range consequences of what I'm doing, what I'm choosing, where I'm going. And sin cannot be separated from death. The remedy for sin, that's part of this lesson, you're right. Romans 5:16-19, but one man not as it was by one that sinned, so is the gift. One man, or Adam and Eve brought on all this, Jesus came to undo all the works of the devil. Therefore, as by the offense of one, judgment came upon all men to condemnation, even so by the righteousness of one, that's talking about Jesus Christ. But the righteousness of one, the free gift, came upon all men unto justification of life. Legal terms are being used here. The verdict of the court on those who participate willfully in Adam's transgression is condemnation, that is, guilty. But the other side of this is justification. Jesus died to justify us, redeem us, to bring us back into right relationship with God, into God's image. Paul wanted to stress the superior influence of Christ's work over Adam's work. Humanity was intended for royalty. Excuse me. Royalty, to have dominion. Of course, we lost all that and gave it to the devil. And Christ came to get it back. Praise the Lord. My throat's bad and I'm going to shut up. Thank you for your attention.